Like a dozen other towns, ours was named to honor the U.S. naval hero, Stephen Decatur. He was the man who said, our country may she always be right, but our country right or wrong. That feeling is still highly regarded hereabouts. This was all Cherokee land till Andrew Jackson thought to move the Indians elsewhere. In the last 100 years, Decatur's grown steadily. About 15,000 in the 1930 census. I've been doing my job here as circuit judge of Alabama's 8th Judicial District since the people first elected me 8 years ago. A well-ordered life, moving toward achievable goals, in no special hurry. But 50 miles to the northeast, the Chattanooga to Memphis Freight is just dipping down across the Alabama border.
I'm going to Stevenson. I'm gonna fix them niggers.
Like you guys run through the ration machine.
Yeah, a bunch of niggers jumped us.
Yeah, where was this?
We was camped down the track there a ways. They just swarm all over us, no damn good reason either. Hurt this poor old boy here pretty bad. And then we was just getting a measure of them. They jump on that westbound freight, got clean away.
Why are you telling me this?
We want them niggers got.
You willing to press charges?
You bet we are. Yeah. Well, they ain't getting away with this.
Hold! please.
We got a cop on here. Oh, Mel.
Names.
Charlie Weems. That's Ozzy Powell. That's Clarence Norris. Olin there. Olin Montgomery. He's near blind.
What are you doing with a stick, boy?
I can't.
Willie. He's doing poorly. Willie Robeson.
Where are you boys from?
We all from Georgia.
What are you doing on that train?
Going to Memphis, Sheriff, looking for work.
And you?
My name's Haywood Patterson.
This is Gene Williams. And he's Andy Wright. That's his little brother, Leroy.
You boys skip out of Georgia, too?
No. We from Chattanooga.
All right. Let's get a line on him. Head back to Scottsboro.
Hey, Sheriff, look at what we supposed to have done.
Sheriff, he was on the train, too.
Put him on the truck.
Hey! Hey, wait. That ain't no way to treat a couple of girls.
I don't see no girls. All I see is a couple of bums.
After what we've been through on that train?
What have you been through? What happened on that train, girl?
Me and my friend, Victoria.
Go on.
We was both raped. By them.
No.
All of them!
Just after dawn, on the morning of March 30th, 1931, before a crowd could collect, before the town could hear, 9 Negro boys, ages 13 to 20, were brought under guard to the Scottsboro courthouse, were indicted for rape, and went on trial for their lives. 8 were speedily found guilty as charged. In the case of 13-year-old Roy Wright, the jury could not agree, and the judge reluctantly declared a mistrial. The jury's disagreement was not in regard to Roy's guilt or innocence. All voted him guilty, but 7 of the 12 were holding out for the electric chair for the 13-year-old boy. For the first time in the history of the United States, 8 persons were sentenced to death on the same day for the same crime. But this was only the beginning.
Shortly before 11 o'clock this morning, Chief Justice Charles Evans Hughes nodded to Associate Justice George Sutherland. The justice briefly summarized the background of the sensational case and then moved to the body of the decision. The court restricted itself to one question, that question being whether the defendants were in substance denied right of counsel and whether such denial infringes...
New York City commoners are dancing in the streets.
And buying railroad tickets for Alabama.
Pendleton hearing at 2:30.
Shrewd old man, Hughes. Have a conservative read the decision. Medicine still tastes better, no matter who holds a spoon.
The Society for the Protection and Promotion of Enlightened Inequality. Yes,
our founding father.
You may approach the bench, Jim.
Or you may even sit on it.
You're late today.
Well, I was detained by a matter of some importance. An extra large bowl of vegetable soup with plenty of crackers.
Jim, the action that was filed against the county road commissioner...
Very delicate matter.
So yes. Who better to handle it than you?
Some people in Decatur stand to lose a lot of money if that case goes against the commissioner.
Other people stand to make a lot of money. Way of the world.
Well, now, Jim, how do you propose to save financial inequality if we get no help from our friends?
There'll be no decision for a week at least. Our greed has been served. May I concentrate on gluttony?
You said you were detained on a matter of some importance.
An obvious bait.
I was listening to the radio. How's the market doing?
Poor Tyler. He still clings to the cotton futures.
The United States Supreme Court reversed the Alabama ruling. The Scottsboro boy is going to have to be retried.
Oh.
Oh, Lord. I have said it over and over. The communists are running everything up north.
And we have heard it over and over.
And you're not campaigning for re-election at this table.
Who wrote the decision, Jim?
Justice Sutherland.
Strict instructionist, states rights man.
Not your ordinary garden variety communist.
What grounds?
Inadequate counsel, due process.
Mm.
This reversal has got to be the worst insult ever handed a state Supreme Court.
The state court did a whitewash, not a very smooth one.
Yeah, but nothing about this case has been handled right from the start.
Jeb, you don't know the meaning of fear. We've all come to accept that. But old Al Hawkins and the other boys at Scottsboro, they lay no claim to being bona fide grade A heroes like you. So when they found 4,000 or 5,000 screaming rednecks on the courthouse lawn banging on the doors, they decided to put a little extra spin on the wheels of justice. They figured to get things moving before 9 ropes, 9 telephone poles, and 9 black necks came together. Unfortunately, a few legal niceties got lost along the way.
Well, here we are, almost 2 years later, about to run the same damn gauntlet.
Well, our tempers have cooled.
Well, this decision's gonna reheat them. New trial. Now that is gonna cost the state, and that's you and me, a whole pile of money, and it's not gonna change a thing. A nigger rapes a white woman, he dies.
If economy is what you're after, Oz, nothing cheaper than rope.
Everybody would just keep calm. I mean, you say Scottsboro, and you might think it was the first time Alabama ever tried a nigger for rape.
First time we ever had 9 lined up at once.
I've talked to a lot of darkies about this, and they don't like this a bit better than we do. A
bunch of burrheads come in here from Georgia, Tennessee, mess with the white woman.
This thing goes on, now you know that the Klan's gonna start riding.
Mm-hmm.
You suppose that affect property values out there?
What day is this?
What difference does it make to you?
What day is this?
Tuesday. Told you that 6 times already this morning. Tuesday. January 17th, 1933. January 17th, 1933. What you hanging on to remembering such as that?
Hanging on. Hanging on to what I get left.
Oh, okay. What's that?
Oh, I can't. I cry, but it hurt. Oh.
Well, we all hurt.
Oh.
You in my life. Life, dog, and old hens scratching for bugs make better tracks than those.
Speaking now.
One day, I'm gonna write a letter.
Mm-hmm. Why don't Mama go see us no more?
She out trying to get people to help us.
Well, there she is.
Europe, they see. I don't know.
How do people go to help us?
Ain't nobody gonna help us. Yes, they is. Got a letter right here. We will have you boys out soon. It says that. You been told?
Andy.
Today is Tuesday, Owen.
Now listen, Newland, that boulder's slipping. Can't you get a tighter grip on it?
Well, not with this Stone Age tool.
Yeah.
What we need is a smaller wrench.
Maybe what we should have is a mechanic.
Oh, I wouldn't let any mechanic in Morgan County touch this car.
Well, now, down in Montgomery...
I know. You've got all the advantages of civilization. You probably have a state maintenance crew looking after your jalopy.
Well, Jim, I do a lot of traveling in the interest of the taxpayer.
You try this one.
You know, this is no kind of car to be using on these backcountry roads. You'd be better off with a Model T truck or maybe a spring wagon.
Well, I don't mean always to be driving off the main highways and avenues, but
Not all of us get where we're going as fast as you did, Newland.
I'm not quite there yet.
What? Man who calls all the shots for the governor? Here right, there left?
More right than left.
That man will soon be behind the wheel.
You know, Jim, sometimes a man has to pay a high price for your friendship.
Now try to get a hold of it a little higher up, will you?
How's this?
Yeah. You got it?
Yep.
Hang on.
Yep.
Yeah. Now, I think we got it. Now, let's test that. Want to get those coveralls off?
Yeah.
A little tight, Jim.
Yeah. I think you've been eating a lot, Newland.
It's that high living. You know, there are shortcuts to Montgomery.
So I've heard. Start her up.
Yeah! Looks tight as a drum. Well, the bill for my services may be handled in small installments.
Couldn't I just come into Montgomery and work on your car instead?
Well, I hope you'll be too busy.
Oh, my spring docket isn't that heavy.
Week after next, the defense lawyers for the Scottsboro boys are going to appear before Judge Hawkins.
Oh, the great Samuel Leibowitz invades Alabama. Surprised me he tied in with the communists.
They took him on his own terms. No interference.
You know, Newland, for a man who recommends shortcuts, you do take the long way around.
You wouldn't ask a fellow politician to be consistent.
Where are we headed, Newland?
Leibowitz and company are going to ask for a change of venue.
Yeah, and the odds around here favor Birmingham.
Out of the money.
Newland.
Hawkins, Chief Justice Andrews, my boss. Everybody wants to move the new trials to your courtroom, if you'll agree to it.
Why should I?
You're conscientious, ambitious, and smart.
What smart man would get involved with the Scottsboro boys?
The smart man who is also ambitious. This is your shortcut to Montgomery, Jim.
I knew a man who took a shortcut once, saved half a day, and was eaten by wolves.
Obviously, he wasn't as well armed as you are.
Is this an official request?
Unofficial, official.
Well, I want to think it through.
The trial hearings are set for March the 6th.
Give me a day or two.
Now, Jim, be ashamed to waste a fine car like this on backcountry roads.
Come on inside. Get something to sip on.
I've been hearing about what the good things this can do for you. Out of the back rooms of Morgan County, petty politics, into Montgomery's tapestried council chambers.
You paint a very pretty picture, my dear.
Yeah, well, what I'm wondering is what's in it for Newland Andrews and the men who sent him.
Well, I have the satisfaction of knowing that they've served the people well.
Sometimes when you say things like that, Jim, I worry you half believe them.
Newland's rewards don't interest me.
Well, so far we've just been talking rewards. And looking on the bright side, suppose this trial doesn't go as you hope. Suppose this hornet's nest they want to toss you breaks apart in your hands. Who's going to get stung and stung and stung? Not Newland Andrews or the governor or the chief justice. Jim Horton gets stung to death.
Well, there are risks.
What you do in Morgan County, Jim, you do well. Nobody could do any better. One day that'll be recognized.
You don't think I can handle this hornet's nest?
Can anybody? Why risk it?
Well, I'm getting a very strong vote of no confidence.
You're the one change I ever made in your office. We'd been married about 3 years, I think. Your practice was doing well, but you were thinking of overextending yourself. You were thinking of defending that mill organizer.
The portrait! You came in one day and very calmly took down the portrait of Lincoln I had hanging over my desk.
You putting that picture back up again, Jim, in your mind?
Well, I'm not trying to be Abraham Lincoln.
I'm relieved to hear it.
What you doing?
I'm thinking about an old mule on the farm we share crop. He was hitched to a wheel, and day after day, just kept going round and round, telling himself he was on the way out. Gossip, shut up.
I know this ain't no good.
We'll start that.
No, this ain't here. Why they keep us here? Why they keep us here?
We niggas. That's why.
What day is this?
I've been going over the transcripts of the Scottsboro trials.
See if you can get a call through to Newland, Andrews, and Montgomery, will you?
Are we going to do it?
We're going to do it.
Oh. If the trials are over, you're sure to have worldwide recognition.
Of one kind or another.
Operator, I'd like to put a call in to Senator Newland, Andrews, and Montgomery. That's
right. In Decatur, as in Scottsboro, the state of Alabama would try each of the boys separately, and Haywood Patterson was selected to be the first. Defiant, outspoken, Patterson was not at all representative of the other boys. As the defendant most likely to be quickly convicted by an Alabama jury, Patterson was a shrewd leadoff choice for the prosecution, a choice which strangely went unchallenged by the defense.
Getting the job done, Noah?
Trying.
This should nicely accommodate the visiting gentlemen of the press.
Gentlemen? Coming down here and looking down that Yankee noses at us?
Don't make it too comfortable. They'll be dozing off. What's this?
Well, there's two Negro riders coming down, and that's for them.
Morning, Judge.
Morning, bud.
Finally got the defendant settled into jail. Free to a cell.
Give any trouble?
They just don't listen. Tell them what to do maybe five times. They turn around and ask you, what should I do? You know, Judge, regular, there's just me and two deputies.
What are you getting to, bud?
Well, them militia men that brought the niggers over from Kilby said they're going back tonight.
Well, the Scottsboro boys have Morgan County's responsibility from now until the trial's over.
It ain't fair. Why us? We ain't set up for it.
Should be fairly routine.
There wasn't nothing routine about it in Scottsboro. I was over there. Machine guns, troops, and old Sheriff Juan was still sweating blood till he got rid of
it. Now, that's a different situation, bud.
Too many men just standing, staring. Some of them I ain't never seen. Main thing, though, is that jail. Anybody can bust out of that jail. There have been so many escapes the past 2 years, the papers don't even bother to write them up.
Are you worried about keeping the Scottsboro boys in or other people out?
Well, if them militia leave, I ain't gonna be held responsible whatever happens.
All right. I'll request the militia. What'll put your mind at ease, bud? A platoon, a company, a regiment?
Company.
Won't do one bit of good. Them bugs likes it.
They eats it and they ask for more.
Quit talking, I said. Do you hear?
I hear. You won't have to burn me. You're gonna eat me alive.
Trouble with you, boy, you ain't never satisfied.
Don't be looking out that window.
They just stand out here looking at the jail. Why they do that?
Of course they scared.
Scared of what?
Us.
You crazy? Why they be scared of? We locked up.
Don't ask me why they scared. We ask them.
What you think of the new lawyers?
He keep talking a lot about winning, like tomorrow he's going to a horse race.
One thing, he easy to talk with.
For white man.
Why do a man like that come down here?
Money.
He say he not.
He say a lot of things.
He say we all going to be free, going up north and live like kings.
I don't want to go north. I want to go back to Tennessee.
Yeah, well, I'm going any direction, including straight up, long as I get that Alabama.
Mr. Lewis.
Morning, Haywood.
Shows a lonesome walk from the jail.
Yeah, well, you missed the company of the other boys.
You're not alone, Haywood. You got millions of friends all over the world.
Friends and comrades.
Yeah, well, not many of them showed up here this morning.
All rise. This Circuit Court of Alabama's 8th Judicial District, Judge James Edwin Horton, Jr. presiding, is now in session. Before we face the arduous and difficult task of selecting a jury, I have a few things that I feel I must say. I'm aware that in this courtroom and in the streets of Decatur, an ugly and vicious campaign has been launched. A campaign aimed at promoting violence against officers of this court. Now, gentlemen, under our laws, we know neither Jew nor Gentile. We know neither black nor white. To each, it is our duty to mete out even-handed justice. Only by obeying all the laws of the land can a free people enjoy the benefits of liberty. No other course is open to us. And let no one think he can act otherwise. Mr. Knott, Mr. Leibowitz, let us begin the selection of the jury. You may be seated.
And so it began. The careful and yet alarmingly haphazard process of finding the chosen 12. The 12 persons from Morgan County ideally qualified to judge fairly, impartially, on the basis of the evidence alone. The Alabama law required that a juror be generally respected, honest, intelligent, esteemed in his community for integrity, good character, and sound judgment. Only certified angels need apply. The prosecution challenged the younger candidates, town residents who might not yet be mature enough to recognize the urgency of maintaining the status quo at all costs. On the other hand, the defense managed to eliminate most of the redneck types who had held the whip hand on the Scottsboro jury. Prosecution, defense, the court. We all wanted a jury that was clearly well-balanced, fully representative. Three farmers, two mill workers, a barber, a salesman, a bank cashier, a storekeeper, and a draftsman. A fair sampling? A reasonable balance. Socially, economically, educationally. Fair? Reasonable. All male. All white.
We got a telegram from the ILD office this morning.
We didn't, Joe. You did.
Well, everyone's very happy with the way you did the jury selection.
Everybody? We got good notices from the Daily Worker?
New York wondered if there'd be any value in bringing some of the boys' mothers to Decatur.
Absolutely not. Now, as far as the people in the state are concerned, all those ladies are now card-carrying communists. Now, you put your label on those women when you and the NAACP fought it out over who was going to defend the boys. Now, you use them then. You can't have it both ways.
Sam, I agree.
Careful, that's twice this week.
This trial, we steer clear of anything political, yeah? Scrambled eggs, soft, sausages well done, give me oatmeal, and give me hotcakes with some jam or something, you know, no syrup and coffee.
No, I'm sorry, sir, I ain't got no oatmeal, but grits come with it.
What?
Grits.
Grits?
That's wonderful. Oh. Got a little best wishes telegram this morning.
Didn't know the NAACP was still in business.
Yeah, they're waiting in the wings.
Well, instead of waiting, you better start running, catch up with the rest of this country. I wish we could have worked with them, but...
Yeah, but working with them means compromise.
Sam, with you we compromised.
But I didn't.
You know, it's possible to be right and still see the need to compromise, Sam.
Like you said, for the next couple of weeks, we'll forget about politics.
And remember those boys. Our first witness this morning is Miss Victoria Price. Recommendation. Restraint. We can get what we want without carving the woman up. Scottsboro transcript made things very clear. That woman is the flower of Southern womanhood.
Listen, I agree. She's a marvelous human being.
Sam, the jury don't want to hear that. Defense in the last trial made one thing very clear. Victoria was a whore, and they got it in the neck for it. Now, those two women are sainted virgins in white, the flower of Southern womanhood.
And our boys are a bunch of cannibals.
Knight doesn't have to say that. The jury's got it already fixed in their heads.
Joe, when you're right, you're right.
Yeah, so where's my breakfast? Here, use some water.
I think this is a little too flashy. I'll change the tie. I'll see you in court.
State calls Victoria Price. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Be seated.
Victoria, where is your home?
Huntsville, Alabama.
And why did you go to Chattanooga in March of 1931?
Ruby, my friend and me, we went up there looking for work in the cotton mills. We went up there on a Tuesday.
That would have been March 24th.
Yes, sir. We got in about 7:30 that evening and went to see Callie Broche. She runs a boarding house 5 blocks from the railroad yards.
So you spent Tuesday night at Mrs. Broche's?
We did. Then next day, Callie went with us to every one of them mills. It was no use. We could tell that, Ruby and me. We decided if we was gonna be out of work, better it should be in Huntsville than Chattanooga.
So you decided to return home.
Mrs. Broche took us to the railroad yards. Saw Ruby and me off on the Chattanooga to Memphis freight.
Do you recall what kind of car it was you boarded in Chattanooga?
I do. It was an open tank car.
Were there others in the car with you and Ruby Bates?
No, sir. We had that car to ourselves. Nobody else wanted it. It was too open. When the train stopped in Stevenson, I said to Ruby, let's find ourselves someplace warmer. We come to this gondola and decided to give it a try.
Was this car also unoccupied?
No, sir. There were some boys there.
Do you remember how many?
7 or 8.
Black or white?
They was all whites. One of them was real kind, helped Ruby and me into the car.
Do you happen to know who this young man is?
We found out later his name was Gilly. Orville Gilly.
You spoke with Gilly?
We exchanged a few remarks. But it was no loving conversation.
Did Gilly stay in the car with you?
No, sir. When that car started to move, Ruby and me, we settled ourselves in the corner. It was much warmer.
And then what happened?
Less than 5 minutes after we left Stevenson, I looked up, and I saw these 12 niggers leaping over the top of the boxcar next to us.
Were these men armed?
2 was waving pistols, and everyone had his knife open. They was all yelling, get off! Get off! The biggest of them, he hit one of the white boys over the head and threw him over the side. The other boys, they was fighting, but there was too many of the niggers. And one by one, they was all forced off, except Orville.
Orville Gilly, he stayed in the gondola with you.
They was gonna throw him off, too. Train got moving too fast, so they let him stay.
Where were you and your friend during the fight?
We stayed right there in that corner.
The white boys were forced off the train. What happened? Victoria.
Nine of the niggers, they come at Ruby and me. 6 of them grabbed me, and the rest went for Ruby. It took 2 to take off my clothes, and they could never have done that if they didn't have knives and guns.
They threatened you with knives and guns as well as forcibly holding you down?
One of them held my legs. And the other had a knife at my throat. And then they started. And him, that Hayward Patterson, he was one of the first.
The defendant, he was one of the attackers?
That's him, Patterson.
The defendant penetrated you?
Yes, he did.
Miss Price, I'll ask you to examine this garment. Are these the step-ins you had on that occasion?
Objection. This is the first time in 2 years since this alleged rape that any such step-ins have been shown.
Well, they're here now.
The court has the right to clear this room, and if it is necessary to do so to keep order, the court will exercise that right. Anyone who can't control his feelings belongs outside.
Your Honor, the state would like to enter these step-ins as Exhibit A.
Objection! This is a shameless and theatrical display.
Objection overruled.
Your witness.
Easy.
Miss Price, Shall I call you Miss Price or Mrs. Price?
Miss Price.
Mrs. Price, this is an exact model of the train on which you rode with Ruby Bates.
That don't look like any train I rode on.
No, what difference do you see?
That's not the train I was on. It was bigger, lots bigger. That's a toy.
Agreed. This is only a model. But the types of cars and their relationship to one another are the same.
It's not the same.
In what way?
I won't say.
What, are you refusing to answer my question?
How can I answer what I don't understand?
Very well. For the moment, we'll turn to something you may find a little easier to understand. The defense offers an evidence, records from the Huntsville, Alabama City Court, which shows that Victoria Price was found guilty of adultery and fornication on January 26, 1931, with her boyfriend, Jack Tiller, who was married.
Objection.
She was fined and sentenced to a term in jail.
Objection.
Mr. Knott.
The state doesn't care if the witness has been convicted of 40 offenses. The charge here is rape. Yeah. Also, Your Honor, the Supreme Court has ruled that conviction by a municipal court shall not affect the credibility of a witness.
Objection sustained. The jury is instructed to ignore the conviction.
Mrs. Price, did you see Jack Tiller again after the two of you were convicted of adultery?
Objection. What relevance can this have?
Your Honor, I want to account for her condition, her vaginal condition, which Dr. Bridges is going to testify to.
Overrule the objection. I would permit you to show any sexual relations within approximately 24 hours of the time.
Did you see Jack Tiller again when both of you got out of jail?
I may have.
Did you, in fact, have sexual relations with Tiller a short time before you left Huntsville for Chattanooga in the Huntsville Railroad Yards?
Now, I told you no. I didn't.
Do you know a man named Lester Carter?
He was thrown off the train that day. But I never knew him before that in my whole life.
Mrs. Price, I am going to ask you that question one more time, and I am going to give you an opportunity to change your answer. Did you know Lester Carter before that day? And I want you to answer me yes or no.
I never did know him. I never did know him.
Where did you spend the night before the alleged attack? Was it in a Chattanooga hobo jungle?
I stayed at Callie Broach's boarding house.
Oh. Well, how big was that boarding house? Was it four rooms or five rooms, one story, two stories?
I never did pay any attention to that.
Well, what did you have to eat when you were with Mrs. Broshy?
I don't remember.
What sort of a room was it that you and Ruby slept in?
I can't be positive.
How can you explain the fact that nobody in all of Chattanooga has ever heard of Mrs. Callie Broshy or her boarding house? How do you account for that?
I don't know. Those niggers and the Hayward vibes, and they rape me!
You're a little bit of an actress, aren't you, Mrs. Price?
You're a pretty good actor yourself.
Now, at Scottsboro, you described the attack in much greater detail than you did today. Why is that?
I just told the truth.
I'm sure the memory must be painful.
It was?
It must have been gruesome. Those heavy Negroes
forcing you like brutes. Well, when you got to the doctor's office, were you not crying?
I had just hushed crying. The best I remember, I was crying. I won't say I can't be positive.
You must have been in pain.
I was.
And were you bleeding from the attacks? Were you bleeding from the attacks, Mrs. Price?
Yes, yes. Yes, I was.
We have no further questions at this time.
Mr. Knott.
Mrs. Price, after the white boys were beaten and forced off the train, what was said to you?
They wanted to know if I was going to put out. I told them I wasn't. They threatened to throw me in the river.
And then, Miss Price?
Then one of them said, "Girl, I'm gonna give you a black baby."
This entire testimony is clearly designed to inflame the jury.
Objection overruled.
Thank you, Ms. Price. That's all.
Just 1 minute, Mrs. Price. You testified at 4 different trials immediately after the alleged rape was supposed to have happened. Did you ever say anything like that?
Yes. Of course I did.
Your Honor, I offer in evidence, when they can be produced, transcripts of the previous trials, and I ask the court to take judicial notice that no such statements were ever made by this witness. And I have one more question. In the entire history of the state of Alabama, have you ever heard of a white woman ever being arrested for perjury when she was the complaining witness against a Negro? That's all. Dr. Bridges, I've always been fascinated with medicine, only I was never smart enough, so I decided to become a lawyer instead. Now, you have testified that you examined Victoria Price and Ruby Bates within a half hour of this alleged multiple rape.
I did.
Would you describe the behavior of the two women at the time of your examination?
They seemed completely calm and composed.
Mm-hmm. Physically, were their pupils dilated?
Not abnormally.
Pulse, respiration?
Normal.
Doctor, did you or your associate find semen?
We did, but it was difficult.
Was the semen non-motile?
Completely.
Did this strike you as unusual?
That's true, since a spermatozoa normally lives from 12 hours to 2 days after sexual relations.
In other words, you could not find a single living spermatozoa from a woman who had claimed she had been raped by at least 6 men only an hour and a half before.
That's true.
Now, Mrs. Price has testified here that she was bleeding. Can you corroborate that?
I saw no blood.
Thank you very much, Doctor.
Your Honor, Dr. Marvin Lynch, the other Scottsboro doctor who examined the girl, is scheduled to testify next. But the state requests a conference with you first.
Very well. We will recess for lunch. Proceedings will resume at 2 o'clock.
Your Honor, Dr. Lynch's testimony is only going to be a repetition of what Dr. Bridges already told the court. So the state requests that he be excused.
Mr. Leibowitz?
No. No, we have no objection, Your Honor.
Very well. The request is granted.
Thank you, Judge.
Dr. Lynch, you're free to go back to Scottsboro.
Thank you.
Judge, can I have a word with you?
Oh, I'm sorry, but that wouldn't be enough.
I'm no longer part of the case. You just excuse me.
Even so,
I have to tell you something. I'm not going to rest till I do.
All right, come back to my chamber.
Now, somebody might see me. Maybe in here.
isn't like the Attorney General said. My testimony wouldn't be a repetition of Doc Bridges. You see, I don't believe those girls were raped.
Well, Dr. Lynch, the place for you to express that
belief. From the first, I felt they were shamming. Well, after we examined them, Doc said, Marv, neither one of them had any indications of having been raped.
You're telling me that from the beginning, you felt certain that the girls were lying and those boys were innocent?
Judge, I looked at both of those women and told them they were lying, that they knew they hadn't been raped. They laughed at me.
Well, you have to say that on the witness stand.
I can't. The way people are feeling now in Scottsboro, if I went on the stand for those niggas, there'd be a burning cross on my parents' lawn and I'd never be able to go back to Jackson County. I only got out of med school 4 years ago. Just finding my place. I'm not starting over somewhere else.
Why did you tell me?
I have to say it to somebody. Maybe you can do something.
Take your responsibility.
Where you sit is a whole lot different from where I'm at.
From where I sit, I can force you to take the stand.
You put any pressure on me, Judge, I'll deny you and me ever spoke of this.
There are two witnesses who could clear those boys.
Oh?
One is Lynch, the Scottsboro doctor who didn't take the stand. He has to be excused because he'd have to testify that those women were never raped at all.
Saving his own skin at any price.
Absolutely. I've been trying to decide if it's my duty to dismiss the case.
If you dismiss the case, Judge Jim Horton is finished. Would it end it for the boys?
New trial, different judge.
I hear those hornets buzzing very loud.
15 years I've sat on the bench, I've never come close to anything like this. Why, playing politics, being a judge, has come as natural as breathing. Whatever needed to be done, I did. But nothing ever really stretched me or made me reach till this. It's like when I was a boy and went to visit relatives up in New England. It was wintertime, and skating was the thing to do. Well, I'd never tried it, but I was venturesome. It was easy. Skimming over the surface, nothing to it. And then, crack, the ice broke, and I was in that dark, freezing water with the ice over me, fighting for breath, for light. This trial makes me feel the same way.
I'll be going into court with you tomorrow. You said two witnesses could clear the boys. Who's the other?
Ruby Bates.
And when will she be called?
Well, she's disappeared. Both the defense and the prosecution have been trying to find her, so they say. But her testimony could be damaging to either side.
But if it would clear the boys...
Could, not necessarily would. At the moment, Victoria Price's version of what happened on that train can only directly be challenged by those boys. They're black, she's white.
Mr. Ramsey, in what section of Chattanooga do you live?
My place is near the railroad yards.
Is there a hobo jungle in that same vicinity?
Right next door to me.
Were you in or near that hobo jungle on March 25th, 1931?
Yes, sir. I went past there on my way to the store. As I come along, I seen these two women.
Hey there!
I do.
You know when that Huntsville train pulls out?
Usually about 9. Sometimes after.
My husband and me, we come up here looking for work. No luck.
Nobody's got much luck nowadays.
My old man's uptown now, scrounging for food.
Well, hope your luck changes. About 9:30 that same day, I saw those girls and a fella get on board the Huntsville train.
Will the bailiff bring in Victoria Price?
Objection. This kind of identification is meaningless.
Overruled. Bailiff,
Victoria Price?
Mr. Ramsey, is this the girl who spoke to you?
Well, she seems to be the same girl. I mean, well, it's kind of like she's heavier now. But yes, I recognize her. It's the girl.
Have you ever seen this woman? Have you ever seen this woman before?
Yes, sir. She was the quiet one.
Thank you, Mr. Ramsey. Your witness?
Mr. Ramsey, you saw two women in a hobo jungle 2 years ago.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. And how long were you with them?
I don't understand, sir.
Well, I mean, how long were you looking at them? 2 minutes, a minute, less than a minute?
A minute. Just about a minute.
And 2 years later, you have a perfectly clear memory of what these two women looked like.
It was them. I ain't forgotten. It was them.
No further questions.
You got to put up with this Jew lawyer telling us what to do.
And you call yourself Alabama's and you let that Jew treat one of our women this way?
Ask me what we should do. Everybody knows what should be done.
Drive that commie Jew out of town on a rail.
So I'll take care of those niggas. All of them.
I want you to take Mrs. Horton out the back way and escort her home.
Jim?
Just go along.
Jim, what's chafing you?
Them!
Oh, now, hold on, Jim. Just cool down.
Don't fob me off with cliches. I can hear what those rednecks are saying.
Now, Jim, you're talking about a majority of folks in this town.
Also been told there was a meeting last night.
A few people got together?
Over 200 men.
Well, you know, there are plenty of folks that don't like what's going on in your courthouse.
They don't have to like me or what I'm doing. Well, no mob is taken over here.
Well, it's my job to see that that don't happen, Jim.
It's my job to see that you do your job.
You saying I ain't?
You're to place a fire engine on standby alert.
Oh, now, hold on. I can't do that.
Joe, you and I have been friends for a good many years, but if you won't carry out my orders, I'll get another officer who can and will.
All right. A fire engine.
Now, if a mob assembles, you're to try high-pressure water first. Now, if that fails, use tear gas. And as a last resort...
Water, tear gas, what next?
You'll have to fire on them.
You talk about a mob. Just putting a label on it don't change the fact that your friends and neighbors that will be shooting.
I'm facing it.
And you still take that responsibility.
I have taken that responsibility.
I asked to have the jury removed because I want to make an announcement. Word has reached me that some action is to be taken against the defendants or their counsel. The guilt or innocence of Haywood Patterson and the other boys is for the jury alone to decide. Now, any man on the outside who has not heard the testimony and would try this case from rumor has no right to say whether they are guilty or innocent. I want it known everywhere that this court intends to protect the prisoners and every other person connected with this trial. I say this, any man who attempts to take the life of one of these prisoners can expect to forfeit his own life the gods assigned to protect them will do so even if it means forfeiting their lives. Now, don't think for one minute that I'm saying this from any routine sense of duty. This comes from my feelings. I have no patience with the mob spirit. I don't think that I would ever harm another human being wrongfully, but there will be no compromise with mob violence. Now, I've spoken harshly. I've spoken the truth. I hope there will be no more of this cowardly and despicable conduct. Let the jury return.
Let the jury return.
The defense calls Willie Robertson.
Willie Robertson.
Willie, how long have you been sick like this?
Long while, sir. 3 or 4 years.
You have syphilis?
Yes, sir.
And gonorrhea?
That's right.
On the day that you were arrested, were you in pain?
Can't hardly move, sir. The swelling and all.
Where were you on the train, Willie?
When the train stopped at Steve's, I found my old boxcar and crawled in.
And when did you leave that boxcar?
I never did. Not until the train stopped.
Which was?
At the paint rock, where they hustled everybody off the train.
They found you in that boxcar?
Yes, sir. Told me to get out fast.
Willie, Victoria Price has testified that you were one of the defendants who leaped off a boxcar onto a gondola, fought and scuffled with several white boys, and then raped her. Were you capable of that?
No, sir.
Well, that's all.
No questions.
Disease racked Willie. Orphan since he was 2. Olin Montgomery, blind in his left eye, with only 10% vision in his right. On his own since he was 7. Ozzie Powell, confused, bewildered, with less than 3 months of schooling in his entire life. One by one, the defense asked us to look at the Scottsboro boys. The halt, the blind, the illiterate. Not as tokens or shibboleths, but as vulnerable, broken human beings. As they faltered, wavered, fought panic, it brought to my mind pictures of doomed sheep, helplessly stumbling toward the slaughter pen.
After the fight, after the white boys jumped over the side, what did you do, Andy?
The four of us was traveling together. Hayward, Gene Williams, my brother and me. We went back into the tank car.
You left the gondola immediately?
Yes, sir. And we stayed in that tank car till we was arrested in paint rock.
Now, Andy, please show us on the model the gondola where the fight took place.
This one.
No box car on either side?
No, sir.
And the tank car where you, your brother, Gene Williams, and the defendant rode?
This one.
Did you at any time see Victoria Price or Ruby Bates?
First time any of us ever seen them was in paint rock.
Mr. Patterson, after the fight, did you and the others end up in the gondola with the white girl?
No. Like I say, we never seen them girls.
Well, have you got a good memory?
Good enough.
Do you remember your trial in Scottsboro? You were tried in Scottsboro.
I was framed in Scottsboro.
Who told you to say you were framed?
I told myself to say it.
Your Honor, I quote from the transcript of the defendant's trial at Scottsboro. I seen Charlie Weems and his four friends ravish that girl, meaning Victoria Price. Did you or did you not say that under oath?
I also say I never seen them
girls. Your Honor, you saw Weems and his four friends ravish that girl. Now, didn't you? Didn't you?
I see a lot of thieves in Scottsboro.
I seen Charlie Weems and his four friends ravish Victoria Price. Did you say that? Answer me.
Objection. Your Honor, I have treated his witnesses with courtesy, and I demand the same treatment for this Negro.
We are not interested in your demands, Mr. Leibowitz.
Will the court please instruct him to stop running at the witness and shouting and shaking that finger of his?
Mr. Leibowitz, please, I must overrule your objection. I cannot so instruct counsel.
We don't need instruction in proper courtroom behavior from visiting Yankees.
You need instruction in common decency from somebody.
Gentlemen, if you persist, I'll have no choice but to cite you both for contempt.
The defense calls Lester Carter.
Defense calls Lester Carter. You get it, boy.
Help you got?
Sure.
Lester, do you know Victoria Price?
Yeah, I do.
Where did you meet her?
Well, I met her and her boyfriend Jack Tiller when we was all in the Huntsville County Jail. They had me on vagrancy.
When you were all released, did you pursue the friendship?
Well, first night out.
Which was?
March 22nd, 1931, the first night. I went with Jack to call on Victoria and her mother. Jack and Victoria, after a little bit, they went into the bedroom, and I stayed there talking to the old lady. And then when they come out, Victoria, she promised he'd get me a date with a friend of hers, Ruby Bates.
Well, did she keep her promise?
Yeah, she sure did. And the very next night, the four of us ended up down in the Huntsville freight yards there together.
What happened in the freight yards?
Hung my hat on a rusty nail and went at making love to Ruby.
Did Victoria and Tiller do the same?
Oh, yeah, they sure did.
Sure, I am sick of Huntsville. Nothing here for nobody.
She thinking of moving on?
Anywhere else be better. Tell me, Chattanooga's a lively old town. Ruby and me could hustle up there. While you two find some kind of fill-in work? What'd you say? Jack.
Sounds fine to me. I'm gay.
Okay. Ruby and me, we get some clothes. We hit up there tomorrow.
Fine. In the meanwhile.
And next evening, there we were in beautiful Chattanooga. It's there we met this feller, said his name was Carolina Slim. We found out later it was really Orville Gilly.
Did you and Ruby have sexual relations that night?
Sure, we had at it.
And what about Victoria and Orville Gilly?
Well, I couldn't say. I wasn't paying much mind to them.
So did the four of
What happened the next morning?
Nothing looked good.
We decided to hit on back for Huntsville.
Did you all board the train together?
Girls decided to ride separate. And then me and Gilly, we split up too.
Lester, how did the fight with the Negroes start?
Well, there's me and some others. We was freezing our tail off in this open place, you know. And we seen them Negroes there in this gondola car. And we decided, hell, move them out, take it on over.
But they surprised you?
There's too many of them. I ain't no hero.
So they forced you off the train?
Well, yeah, they sure did. Made me mad. I went on back to Stevenson. I seen that station master. I told him, call ahead. Get them Negroes pull off that train.
Did you see Victoria and Ruby again?
Well, right soon after I was taken that Scottsboro jail by that deputy, Victoria and Ruby rode up in a car.
Did you speak with them?
Well, Victoria called a bunch of us who'd been on that train over the car, and she said, now look, one of you boys got to play like you're my brother. If you don't, we all gonna be arrested for hoboing.
She asked you to pretend to be her brother?
Yes, she did. But I told her I wasn't gonna lie to the law, no sir. She said, hell, she finds somebody else.
And did she find somebody else?
Sure. And then later on, I seen her go after that Gilly, too, but for a different reason.
You was the only white boy left on the train. Now, you gotta say you seen them niggas rape me and Ruby.
I ain't never seen no such thing.
Well, it ain't gonna hurt you none to say you did. You gotta back us up.
You can just go hang.
What's the matter with you?
I ain't gonna lie about them niggers.
What the hell do we care about niggers now? It wouldn't bother me none if the law stuck all the niggers in Alabama in jail.
And Gilly, oh hell, he still wouldn't do it. That's why he weren't asked to testify about it in Scottsboro, too.
Thank you, Lester. Your witness?
Why didn't we hear your story in Scottsboro?
I weren't asked.
But you were asked here.
Yes, sir.
You weren't only asked, but you were encouraged, rewarded.
Objection.
Sustained.
Who is paying for your room and board and has been for a month and more?
Mr. Brodsky.
And who put those fancy clothes on your back?
His suit only cost $11.
$11 in communist money.
Objection.
Strike that from the record, please.
No further questions.
Your Honor, the defense rests with reservations.
Very well.
Excuse me, I request permission to approach the bench.
Granted. Mr. Knight.
Delighted to hear it. Prepare for this, Mr. Knight? Well, fine.
Defense calls Ruby Bates. You swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Dry? Would you like a glass of water?
Oh, no. Thank you.
Ruby, on the night of March 23rd, 1931, did you have sexual relations with Lester Carter?
I certainly did.
Did Victoria Price have sexual relations with Jack Tiller in your presence?
She certainly did.
The defense asks that Victoria Price be brought in for identification.
Bailiff, please bring in Miss Price.
Victoria Price.
That's Victoria.
Oh,
with your temper, you hear?
Kind of lies you tell. You ain't that your kind anymore.
Spectators will control themselves, or I'll clear this court.
Ruby, did any rape take place on that Chattanooga to Huntsville train?
Not that I know of, and I was with Victoria every minute.
Why have you been so slow to come forward with this very important testimony?
I was sick of it. You know, all the questions, all the poking and prying, I just had to get away. So I went up north and I worked for a while in New York City. All the while my conscience is bothering me. One day, I read in the paper about this famous minister, Dr. Harry Emerson Fosdick. And I just went to see him.
And what did Dr. Fosdick say?
Told me I had to come back to Alabama, tell the truth.
Thank you very much, Ruby.
Where'd you get that coat?
I bought it.
Where did you get the money to buy it?
Well, I don't know.
Where did you get the hat? Who was your beneficent donor?
Do you know?
No, sir, I don't.
I have here a transcript of your testimony in Scottsboro. One held a knife to my throat, another a gun, and a third one raped me. Did you say that?
Well, I told it just like Victoria told it.
Did you say under oath that you had been raped?
I said it, but Victoria told me I had to.
Oh, so you testify as you're told. Well, now, who told you to say the things we're hearing here today?
Dr. Fosdick told me to come here and tell the truth.
Your Honor, now, it is discourteous to this jury for these people to be snickering and laughing, these rudists, with the blood of this Negro.
If these outbursts continue, I'll cite the offenders for contempt.
Three months ago, were you in my office?
Yes.
And didn't I tell you at that time that I did not want to burn anyone who was not guilty?
I never said nothing at that meeting. Victoria told the whole story.
Didn't I tell you that all I wanted was the truth? Didn't I?
I guess so.
And at that same time, didn't I also say that I would punish anybody who made you swear falsely? Didn't I? Didn't I? Answer me. Yes? Well, she obviously didn't believe me.
The witness is excused.
Whether Haywood Patterson lives or dies will be up to you. Let us assume that the prosecution is prejudiced, and let us assume that the defense is prejudiced. Both sides are trying to prove their point, but it is the sworn duty of each and every one of you to convict only on the evidence, and instead of evidence, the state offers you the uncorroborated testimony of Victoria Price. And what is that testimony? It is the foul, contemptible, outrageous lie of an abandoned woman. Now, I am not defending Ruby Bates, but Ruby Bates is not on trial. Haywood Patterson is. And the question that I ask you, gentlemen, whether even Haywood Patterson, this poor scrap of colored humanity, will receive a fair trial. And I believe that the answer to that question is yes. I believe that you will put aside prejudice, sectionalism, and bigotry, and find Haywood Patterson not guilty.
Counsel for the defense has told you gentlemen what your sworn duty is. I believe you know what it is. I think we can depend upon you as dedicated patriotic citizens to do the right thing. Like six men on the Alabama Supreme Court, you will not compromise. The defense says it has given you evidence. Were you taken in by the learned by rote stories told by the defense's two chief witnesses? I wasn't. But those fancy New York clothes they were showing off did knock my eyes out. Those two sold their Alabama birthrights for a suitcase full of flashy ready-mades. In comparison, 30 pieces of silver was a high price. Lester Carter. Now, he testified real sweet, didn't he? The Negroes did this. The Negroes did that. You would almost think that you were listening to another Leibowitz or Brodsky. It might be Carter Rinke now. If he'd been with Brodsky for another week, he'd have been down here with a pack on his back trying to sell you goods. Are you gonna countenance that sort of thing?
Now, this is the last one. Unless you wish to be cited, you will remain quiet.
Your Honor, on behalf of myself and my associate, Mr. Brodsky, I object to these anti-Semitic slurs and innuendos.
The tone of your summation is offensive, Mr. Knight. Please confine yourself to the pertinent data.
The pertinent data, as we all know, is that a crime has been committed in the state of Alabama. But outsiders are trying to deny us of the right to punish the criminals in our own way. It's the same old story. The meddlers from the North sold slaves and then, in their hypocritical self-righteousness, took them away. Today, here in Decatur, show them Alabama justice cannot be bought and sold with Jew money from New York.
I move for a mistrial. Now, I submit that no conviction in this case is worth a pinch of salt in view of what that man has just said.
Mr. Knight, your summation has been intemperate, prejudicial, and irrelevant to the case.
Your Honor, perhaps I did get a bit carried away.
Mr. Leibowitz, on the basis of these remarks alone, I cannot end this trial.
The law was designed to protect all persons, regardless of station. The law also has a stern duty to perform when women such as Ruby Bates and Victoria Price come before it. The testimony of these two women is flatly contradictory. Ruby Bates has openly admitted on the stand that she perjured herself. On the other hand, evidence was introduced to show that Victoria Price made false statements. And you must remember that both Ruby Bates and Lester Carter
insisted that Victoria Price consorted with Jack Tiller less than 36 hours before the alleged assault. The state has not contradicted this. Now, we are not trying lawyers. We are not trying state lines. We are not trying whether the defendant is black or white. The only duty of this jury is to decide whether there's a reasonable doubt as to the guilt of Haywood Patterson. Gentlemen, the decision rests with you. Bailiff, let the jury retire and consider their verdict.
Taking those
two to me. He locking them in a room.
Same as us?
Oh, surely. There's only one difference. They all white and we's all black.
Whose turn is it out the Haywood?
Charlie. I don't want to go through that again. Well, just tell them, no, sir. Every time I think about it, my head hurts.
We find the defendant guilty as charged and fix punishment at death in the electric chair.
Spending the taxpayers' money, a man might try to salvage a little bit of it for himself.
Morally, you're opposed to him. Financially, you're an ally.
Well, society still seems to be flourishing.
Jim?
We've missed your rapier.
Had to settle for Pomeroy's hatchet work. Well, we've understood that justice sits in the highest places and alone.
You've been mostly staying out at the farm since the trial.
Cultivating my garden, tuning my automobile. But this afternoon is back to duty.
Hearing on the defense motion for a new trial for Patterson.
Routine.
Well, now that the communists and that NAACP have kissed and made up, I suppose they'll try to carry their appeals right back on up to the Supreme Court in Washington.
Maybe Miss Ruby Bates will perform her vaudeville act on the steps of the Capitol.
Well, certainly good to see you all.
Get this thing over with, Jim. Come back to us.
We need your unsettling influence.
Jim looks a little remote. Well, that's the view from
Olympus. Greatness has been thrust upon him.
Everyone else takes him seriously. Why should he be the exception?
Well, it'll be useful knowing somebody on the state Supreme Court.
Tyler, how can anybody be as totally self-serving as you are?
Well, it's partly heredity, Oz. Partly the result of your shining influence.
All rise. Be seated.
The law wisely recognizes that passions, prejudices, and sympathies affect the decisions of juries. But as judge, I have only one question to ask myself. Is there sufficient credible evidence on which to base an honest verdict? The state has built its case largely on the testimony of Victoria Price. If her account is true, there are many possible areas of corroboration. According to Mrs. Price, 8 white boys were in the gondola at the beginning of the fight, and Orville Gilley saw the entire rape. Now, none of those 8 boys took the stand, except Lester Carter. And what did he say? He directly contradicted Mrs. Price. Victoria Price swore that one of the defendants cut her head with the butt of a pistol. Her back was supposedly lacerated by a jagged rock. One would logically expect to find semen in quantities. Further corroboration should be gained from the fact that Mrs. Price supposedly bled from the abuse of the 6 defendants. Dr. Bridges made a careful examination and found no cut on the head, no lacerations on her back, no blood anywhere. When we consider that Victoria Price slept side by side with a man the night before in Chattanooga and had sexual relations with Tiller the night and morning before she came to Chattanooga, the conclusion becomes clearer and clearer. This woman was not forced into sexual relations with all those Negroes on that train. Her condition was due to the sexual relations she had on the 2 nights previous. The testimony of Victoria Price is not only uncorroborated, it is also improbable and contradicted by evidence which greatly preponderates in favor of the defendant. It is therefore ordered by this court that the motion of the defense be granted. The judgment of the jury is herewith set aside, and a new trial for Haywood Patterson is ordered. Court adjourned.
Haywood, this is a new trial. They just threw out the
You understand what that means?
You understand what it means?
Your Honor?
It's
been set aside.
Your Honor?
All right, all right.
In your whole life, you'll never make a bigger mistake.
Don't underestimate me.
You have not only destroyed yourself, but you have helped nobody. And I am telling you here and now that the state is going to retry Patterson and all the others just as soon as possible.
The Attorney General kept his promise to my husband. There was a rush of new trials, and again, all the Scottsboro 9 were found guilty and sentenced to death. More appeals, more trials. None of the 9 did die in the electric chair. Eventually, all were pardoned or paroled, but only after serving a combined total of 130 years in prison. The Scottsboro trials did produce 2 landmark Supreme Court decisions. First, every defendant is entitled to adequate counsel. And second, every man must be tried by a jury of his peers. All white juries must not try black men. Ignoring my wifely advice, Jim did stand for re-election the following year, and he was overwhelmingly defeated. My husband never again held public office.
Thomas Knight, Jr., elected lieutenant governor of Alabama in 1934 in landslide victory.
suffered a fatal heart attack July 5th, 1935. Samuel Leibowitz continued to fight for the Scottsboro boys for 5 bitter years, later served with distinction as judge in New York State. Willie Roberson, pardoned July 24, 1937, after serving 6 years in prison, sought and achieved complete anonymity. Eugene Williams, pardoned July 24, 1937, after serving 6 years in prison, successfully established a new identity and disappeared from the public eye. Olin Montgomery, pardoned July 24, 1937, after serving 6 years in prison, repeatedly arrested drunk and disorderly, settled in Georgia, 1944. Leroy Wright, pardoned July 24, 1937, after serving 6 years in prison, excellent adjustment, then murdered his wife and committed suicide, September, 1959. Charlie Weems, paroled November 7, 1943, served 12 years in prison, dropped quickly into obscurity. Clarence Norris, paroled December 1946, served 15 years in prison, changed identity, and disappeared. Ozzie Powell, paroled December 1946, served 15 years in prison, chronically unemployed because of identification with Scottsboro, changed name, and disappeared. Haywood Patterson, escaped July 1948, served 17 years. Convicted of manslaughter in Detroit, Michigan, 1951. Died of cancer, Michigan State Prison, August 24, 1952. Andy Wright, paroled June 9, 1950. Served 19 years in prison, July 11, 1951. Charged with raping a 13-year-old Albany, New York girl. Charge proved false. Changed identity and disappeared. Ruby Bates failed in an attempted show business career. 1938, contracted tuberculosis and returned to Huntsville. Lived there in semi-seclusion until her death in 1961. Victoria Price, quickly forgotten, lived out her life in Flintsville, Tennessee. Died there in 1961, only a few days after Ruby Bates. Judge James Edwin Horton, Jr., defeated for re-election 1934, never again sought public office, devoted himself to his law practice, farming, and family.
I'm trying to get